Once Hunted, A Riley Paige Mystery, Book 5. Written by Blake Pierce. Narrated by Elaine Wise.
Prologue.
Special Agent Riley Paige's speeding car shattered the silence of Fredericksburg's dark streets. Her 15-year-old daughter was missing. But Riley was more furious than frightened. She had a good idea where April was, with her new boyfriend, 17-year-old high school dropout Joel Lambert. Riley had tried her best to put a stop to the relationship, but she hadn't been successful. Tonight, that's going to change, she thought, with determination. She parked in front of Joel's home, a run-down little house in an unsavoury neighbourhood. She'd been here once before and had given Joel an ultimatum to stay away from her daughter. He'd obviously ignored it. There wasn't a single light on in the house. Maybe nobody was even inside. Or maybe what Riley would find in there would be more than she could handle. She didn't care. She banged on the door.
Joel Lambert, open up, she yelled.
There were a few moments of silence. Riley banged on the door again. This time she heard muttered curses inside. The porch light came on. Still chained, the door opened a few inches. In the light from the porch, Riley could make out an unfamiliar face. It was a bearded, strung-out-looking man of about 19 or 20.
"What do you want?" the man asked groggily.
"I'm here for my daughter," Riley said. The man looked puzzled.
"You got the wrong place, lady," he said.
He tried to shut the door, but Riley kicked it so hard that the safety chain broke loose and the door flew open.
"Hey!"
the man yelled. Riley stormed inside. The house looked much as it had the last time she'd been here, a horrible mess filled with suspicious odours. The young man was tall and wiry. Riley detected a family resemblance between him and Joel, but he wasn't old enough to be Joel's father.
"Who are you?" she asked. "I'm Guy Lambert," he replied.
"Joel's brother," Riley guessed.
"Yeah, who the hell are you?"
Riley whipped out her badge. "Special Agent Riley Paige, FBI," she said. The man's eyes got wide with alarm.
"FBI? Hey, there's got to be some kind of mistake here."
"Are your parents here?" Riley said. Guy Lambert shrugged.
"Parents? What parents?
Joel and I are on our own here." Riley was hardly surprised. The last time she'd been here, she'd suspected that Joel's parents were out of the picture. What had become of them, she couldn't possibly guess.
"Where's my daughter?" Riley said. "Lady, I don't even know your daughter."
Riley took a step toward the nearest doorway. Guy Lambert tried to block her way.
"Hey, aren't you supposed to have a search warrant?" he asked.
Riley thrust him aside.
"I'm making the rules right now," she snarled.
Riley went through the door into a dishevelled bedroom. No one was there. She continued through another door into a filthy bathroom and another door that connected to a second bedroom. Still no one. She heard a voice call out from the living room.
"Hold it right there."
She hurried back into the living room. Now she saw that her partner, Agent Bill Jeffries, was standing in the front doorway. She had called for his help before she'd left home. Guy Lambert was slumped on the sofa, looking despondent.
"This guy seemed to be heading out," Bill said. "I just made it clear that he should wait here for you."
"Where are they?" Riley demanded of Lambert. "Where are your brother and my daughter?"
"I've got no idea."
Riley seized him by the T-shirt and hauled him to his feet.
"Where are your brother and my daughter?" she repeated.
When he said, "I don't know," she slammed him against the wall. She heard Bill let out a groan of disapproval. Doubtless he was worried that Riley might get out of control. She didn't care. Completely panicked now, Guy Lambert spit out an answer.
"They're just down on the next block on this street. 1334.
Riley released him. Without another word, she stormed out the front door as Bill followed after her. Riley had her flashlight out and was checking the house numbers.
"It's this way," she said. "We've got to call for some help," Bill said. We don't need backup, Riley called as she ran along the sidewalk. That's not what worries me. Bill followed her. In a few moments, Riley stood in the yard of a two-story house. It was broken down and obviously condemned, with empty lots on either side, a typical shooting gallery for heroin users. It reminded her of the house where a sadistic psychopath named Peterson had held her captive. He'd kept her in a cage and tormented her with a propane torch until she'd escaped and blown the place up with his own supply of propane. For a second, she hesitated, shaken by the memory. But then she reminded herself, April's in there. Get ready, she told Bill. Bill took out his own flashlight and his gun, and they moved together toward the house. When Riley arrived at the porch, she saw that the windows were boarded up. She had no intention of knocking this time. She didn't want to give Joel or anyone else who was in there any warning. She tried the doorknob. It turned, but the door was locked by a deadbolt. She pulled out her gun and fired, blasting the deadbolt away. She turned the knob again and the door fell open. Even after the darkness outside, her eyes had to adjust as she and Bill stepped into the living room. The only light came from scattered candles. They illuminated a ghastly scene of trash and debris that included empty heroin bags, hypodermics, and other drug paraphernalia. About seven people were visible, two or three of them getting sluggishly to their feet after the racket Riley had made, the rest still lying on the floor or curled up in chairs in a drug-induced stupor. They all looked wasted and ill, and their clothes were filthy and tattered. Riley holstered her weapon. She clearly didn't need it, not yet. "Where's April?" she yelled. "Where's Joel Lambert?" A man who had just stood up said in a foggy voice, "Upstairs." With Bill behind her, Riley made her way up the dark stairway, shining the flashlight ahead of her. She could feel the rotting steps giving under her weight. She and Bill stepped into the hallway at the top of the stairs. Three doorways, one of them leading into a vile-smelling bathroom, had been stripped of their doors and were visibly empty. The fourth doorway still had a door, and it was shut. Riley stepped toward the door. Bill held out his hand to stop her. "Let me go in first," he said. Ignoring him, Riley pushed past him, opened the door, and stepped inside. Riley's legs almost gave out from under her at what she saw. April was lying on a bare mattress, murmuring, "No, no, no," over and over again. She writhed feebly as Joel Lambert struggled to pull off her clothes. An overweight, homely man stood nearby, waiting for Joel to finish his task. A needle and a spoon lay on the candle-lit bedstand. Riley understood in an instant. Joel had drugged April almost into unconsciousness and was offering her as a sexual favour to this repulsive man. Whether for money or some other purpose, Riley didn't know. She drew her weapon again and pointed it at Joel. It was all she could do to restrain herself from shooting him right away. "Back away from her," she said. Joel clearly understood her state of mind. He raised his hands and stepped away from the bed. Indicating the other man, Riley said to Bill, "Cuff this bastard. Take him back to your car. Now you can call for help." "Riley, listen to me." Bill's voice trailed off. Riley knew what Bill was leaving unsaid. He understood perfectly well that all Riley wanted was a few minutes alone with Joel. He was understandably reluctant to allow that. Still keeping her gun pointed at Joel, Riley looked at Bill with an imploring expression. Bill slowly nodded, then went over to the man, read him his rights, cuffed him, and led him outside. Riley shut the door behind them. Then she stood silently, facing Joel Lambert, her gun still raised. This was the boy that April had fallen in love with. But this was no ordinary teenager. He was deeply involved with the drug trade. He had used those drugs on her own daughter, and had obviously intended to sell April's body. This was not a person capable of loving anyone.
"What do you think you're going to do, cop lady?" he said. "I've got rights, you know."
He flashed her the same slightly smirking smile he'd displayed the last time she'd seen him. The gun trembled slightly in Riley's hand. She was itching to pull the trigger and blow this lowlife away. But she couldn't let herself do that. She noticed that Joel was edging toward the end table. He was sturdily built, and he was a bit taller than Riley. He was moving toward a baseball bat, obviously kept for self-defense purposes, that was leaning against the table. Riley suppressed a grim smile. It looked like he was going to do exactly what she wanted him to do.
"You're under arrest," she said.
She holstered her weapon and reached for the cuffs on the back of her belt. Exactly as she'd hoped, Joel lunged for the baseball bat, picked it up, and swung it wildly at Riley. She deftly avoided the blow and braced herself for the next swing. This time, Joel raised the bat high, meaning to smash her head with it. But as his arm came down, Riley ducked and reached for the small end of the bat. She grabbed it, then yanked it away from him. She enjoyed the surprised look on his face as he lost his balance. Joel reached for the end table to stop himself from falling. When his hand was fast against the table, Riley brought the bat crashing down on it. She could hear the bones breaking. Joel let out a pathetic scream and fell to the floor.
"You crazy bitch!" he yelled. "You broke my hand!"
Panting for breath, Riley cuffed him to a bedpost. "Couldn't help it," she said. "You resisted, and I accidentally slammed your hand in the door. Sorry about that." Riley cuffed his undamaged hand to the bottom of a bedpost. Then she stepped on his broken hand and shifted her weight onto it. Joel screamed and writhed. His feet thrashed around helplessly.
"No, no, no!" he shouted.
Still keeping her foot in place, Riley crouched down close to his face. Mockingly, she said,
"No, no, no. Where did I hear those words before? Just in the last few minutes."
Joel was blubbering with pain and terror. Riley pushed down with her foot.
"Who said it?" she demanded. "Your daughter! She said it!"
"Said what?"
"No, no, no!"
Riley let up on the pressure a little.
"And why did my daughter say that?" she asked. Joel could barely speak through his violent sobs. "Because she was helpless and hurting. I get it, I understand."
Riley removed her foot. She figured he got the message, at least for now, although probably not for good. But this was the best or worst she could do for now. He deserved death, or far worse. But she couldn't bring herself to give it to him. At least he would never use that hand properly again. Riley left Joel, cuffed and cringing, and rushed to her daughter's side. April's eyes were dilated, and Riley knew that she was having trouble seeing her.
"Mum," April said, in a low whimper. The sound of that word unleashed a world of anguish in Riley. She burst into tears as she started to help April get back into her clothes. "I'm getting you out of here," she said through her sobs. "Everything's going to be all right." Yet even as she spoke the words, Riley prayed that they were true.
Chapter 1. Riley was crawling through the dirt in a damp crawl space under a house. Total darkness surrounded her. She wondered why she hadn't brought a flashlight. After all, she had been in this awful place before. Again, she heard April's voice call out in the darkness.
"Mom, where are you?"
Despair tugged at Riley's heart. She knew that April was caged somewhere in this evil darkness. She was being tortured by a heartless monster.
"I'm here," Riley called out in reply. "I'm coming. Keep talking so I can find you." "I'm over here,"
April called. Riley crept in that direction, but a moment later she heard her daughter's voice speak from another direction.
I'm over here!
Then the voice echoed through the darkness.
I'm over here! I'm over here! I'm over here!
It wasn't just one voice, and it wasn't just one girl. Many girls were calling for her help, and she had no idea how to reach any of them. Riley was awakened from her nightmare by a squeeze of her hand. She had fallen asleep holding onto April's hand, and now April was starting to wake up. Riley sat up straighter and looked at her daughter lying in the bed. April's face was still somewhat pasty and pale, but her hand was stronger and not cold anymore. She looked much better than she had yesterday. Her night in the clinic had done her a lot of good. April managed to focus her eyes on Riley. Then the tears came, just as Riley knew they would.
Mum, what if you hadn't come?
April said in a choked voice. Riley felt her own eyes sting. April had asked the same question countless times now. Riley couldn't bear to even imagine the answer, much less say it aloud. Riley's cell phone rang. She saw that it was Mike Nevins, a forensic psychiatrist who was also her good friend. He had gotten Riley through a lot of personal crises and had been glad to help with this one. Just checking in, Mike said. I hope I'm not catching you at a bad time. Riley was happy to hear Mike's friendly voice.
Not at all, Mike. Thanks for calling.
How's she doing?
Better, I think. Riley didn't know what she would have done without Mike's help. After Riley had gotten April away from Joel, yesterday had been a bedlam of emergency services, medical treatments, and police reports. Yesterday evening, Mike had arranged for April to be admitted here to the Corcoran Hill Health and Rehab Centre. It was much nicer than the hospital. Even with all the necessary equipment, the room was attractive and comfortable. Through the window, Riley could see trees on well-manicured grounds. Just then, April's doctor came into the room. They ended the call as Dr. Ellis Spears entered, a kindly-looking man with a youthful face but a few telltale grey hairs. He touched April's hand and asked,
"How are you feeling?"
"Not great," she said.
"Well, give yourself some time," he said. "You're going to be fine. Miss Paige, could I have a word with you?"
Riley nodded and followed him out into the hall. Dr. Spears looked over some information on his clipboard.
"The heroin is almost cleared out of her system now," he said. "The boy gave her a dangerous dose. Fortunately, it leaves the bloodstream quickly. She's not likely to have any more physical withdrawal symptoms. The distress she's going through right now is more emotional than physical."
"Is she going to..." Riley couldn't bring herself to finish the question. Fortunately, the doctor understood what she wanted to know. "Relapse or have cravings? It's hard to say. First-time heroin use can feel wonderful, like nothing else in the world. She's not an addict at this point, but she's not likely to forget that feeling. There's always a danger that she'll be drawn back to the glow it gave her." Riley grasped what the doctor was getting at. From now on, it was going to be vitally important to keep April away from any possibility of drug use. It was a terrifying prospect. April now admitted to smoking pot and taking pills. Some were apparently prescription painkillers, very dangerous opioids. "Dr. Spears, I..." For a moment, Riley had trouble forming the question that was on her mind. "I don't understand what happened," she said. "Why would she do something like this?" The doctor smiled at her sympathetically. Riley guessed that he heard this question quite often.
"Escape," he said. "But I'm not talking about a complete escape from life. She's not that kind of user. In fact, I don't think she's really a user by nature at all. Like all teenagers, she runs really short on impulse control. That's simply a matter of an immature brain. She really liked the short-term high those drugs gave her. Fortunately, she hasn't used enough to do herself any lasting harm."
Dr. Spears thought silently for a moment.
Her experience was unusually traumatic, he said. I'm talking about how that boy was trying to exploit her sexually. That memory alone might be enough to keep her away from drugs for good. But it's also possible that emotional distress could be a dangerous trigger. Riley's heart sank. Emotional distress seemed an unavoidable fact of family life these days. We need to watch her for a few days, Dr. Spears said. After that, she'll need lots of care, rest, and help with self-analysis. The doctor excused himself and continued on his rounds. Riley stood in the hall, feeling alone and troubled. Is this what happened to Jilly? She wondered. Could April have ended up like that desperate child? 2 months ago, in Phoenix, Arizona, Riley had rescued a girl even younger than April from prostitution. An odd emotional bond had formed between them, and Riley had tried to stay in touch with her after placing her in a shelter for teenagers. But a couple of days ago, Riley had been notified that Jilly had run away. Unable to return to Phoenix, Riley called an FBI agent there for help. She knew the man felt indebted to her, and she expected to hear from him today. Meanwhile, at least Riley was where she needed to be for April. She was headed back toward her daughter's room when she heard a voice call her name from down the hallway. She turned and saw the worried face of her ex-husband, Ryan, coming toward her. When she'd called him yesterday to tell him what had happened, he'd been in Minneapolis working on a court case. Riley was surprised to see him. Ryan's daughter tended to be low on his list of priorities, lower than his job as a lawyer and much lower than the freedom he was now enjoying as a bachelor. She doubted that he would even show up. But now he rushed toward Riley and hugged her, his face full of concern. How is she? How is she? Ryan kept repeating the question, making it difficult for Riley to reply. She's going to be all right, Riley finally managed to say. Ryan pulled out of the embrace and looked at Riley with an anguished expression. I'm sorry, he said. I'm so, so sorry. You told me that April was having problems, but I didn't listen. I should have been here for both of you. Riley didn't know what to say. Apologies weren't Ryan's style. In fact, she'd expected him to heap all sorts of blame on her for what had happened. That had always been his normal way of dealing with family crises. Apparently, what had just happened to April was terrible enough to affect him. He had surely already talked with the doctor and learned the whole awful story. He nodded toward the door. Can I see her? He asked. Of course, Riley said. Riley stood in the doorway and watched as Ryan rushed to April's bed and took her in his arms. He held his daughter tight for a few moments. Riley thought she saw his back heave with a single sob. Then he sat down beside April and held her hand. April was crying again.
Oh, Daddy, I messed up so bad, she said. You see, I was going through this thing with this guy.
Ryan touched her on the lips to quiet her.
Shh, you don't need to tell me. It's all right.
Riley felt a lump form in her throat. Suddenly, for the first time in a very long time, she felt as if the three of them were a family. Was that a good thing or a bad thing? Was it a sign of better times to come? Or yet another build-up to disappointment and heartbreak? She had no idea. Riley watched from the doorway as Ryan gently stroked his daughter's hair, and April closed her eyes and relaxed. It was a touching sight. When did things go so wrong? She wondered. She found herself wishing she could turn back time to some crucial moment when she'd made some terrible mistake and do everything differently so that all this would never have happened. She felt pretty sure that Ryan was thinking much the same thing. It was an ironic thought, and she knew it. The killer she had taken down the day before yesterday had been obsessed with clocks, posing and arranging his victims like hands on a clock face. And now, here she was, with her own yearnings about time. If only I could have kept Peterson away from her, she thought with a shudder. Like Riley, April had been caged and tormented by that sadistic monster and his propane torch. The poor girl had been struggling with PTSD ever since. But the truth was, Riley knew that the problem went back further than that. Maybe if Ryan and I had never gotten divorced, she mused. But how could that have been avoided? Ryan had been distant and disengaged, both as a husband and a father, aside from being a philanderer. Not that she held him solely to blame. She'd made her own share of mistakes. She'd never struck the right balance between her FBI work and being a mother. And she'd never seen a lot of the warning signs that April was headed for trouble. Her sadness deepened. No, she couldn't think of one particular moment when she could have changed everything. Her life had been too full of mistakes and missed opportunities. Besides, she knew perfectly well that she couldn't turn back time. There was no point in yearning for the impossible. Her phone rang and she stepped out into the hallway again. Her heart beat faster when she saw that the call was from Garrett Holbrook, the FBI agent who had taken on the search for Jilly. "Garrett," she said, taking the call, "what's going on?" Garrett answered in his characteristic monotone.
"I've got good news."
Riley immediately started to breathe easier. "The cops picked her up," Garrett said. "She'd been out on the street all night, without money or anywhere to go. She got caught shoplifting at a convenience store. I'm with her at the police station right now. I'll post bail, but..." Garrett stopped. Riley didn't like the sound of that word, but...
"Maybe I should let her talk to you," he said.
A few seconds later, Riley heard the familiar sound of Jilly's voice.
"Hey, Riley!"
Now that Riley's panic was ebbing away, she was starting to get mad.
"Don't hey me! What did you think you were doing running off like that?" "I'm not going back there," Jilly said.
"Yes, you are."
"Please don't make me go back there!"
Riley didn't reply for a moment. She didn't know what to say. She knew that the shelter where Jilly had been staying was a good, nurturing place. Riley had gotten to know some of the staff, who had been very helpful. But Riley also understood how Jilly felt. The last time they'd talked together, Jilly had complained that nobody wanted her, that foster parents kept passing her over.
"I don't like my past," Jilly had said.
That conversation had ended badly, with Jilly in tears, begging for Riley to adopt her. Riley had been unable to explain the thousand reasons why that was impossible. She hoped this conversation wasn't going to end the same way. Before Riley could think of what to say, Jilly said,
"Your friend wants to talk to you."
Riley heard Garrett Holbrook's voice again.
"She keeps saying that. She won't go back to the shelter. But I've got an idea. One of my sisters, Bonnie, is thinking of adopting. I'm sure that she and her husband would love to have Jilly. That is, if Jilly..."
He was interrupted by squeals of delight from Jilly, who kept yelling,
"Yes, yes, yes!"
over and over again. Riley smiled. It was just the kind of moment she needed right now. "Sounds like a plan, Garrett," she said. "Let me know how it works out. Thanks so much for all your help."
"Anytime," Garrett said.
They ended the phone call. Riley stepped back into the doorway and saw that Ryan and April were now carrying on what seemed to be a carefree conversation. Things suddenly seemed so much better. For all her failings, and Ryan's too, they'd given April a much better life than many other kids had. Just then, she felt a hand on her shoulder and heard a voice.
"Riley?"
She turned and saw Bill's friendly face. As she stepped away from the doorway to talk with him, Riley couldn't help glancing back and forth from her longtime partner to her ex-husband. Even in his current state of distress, Ryan looked like the successful lawyer that he was. His blonde good looks and smooth manners opened doors for him everywhere. Bill, as she had often realized, looked more like she did. His dark hair showed touches of grey, and he was more solid and much more rumpled than Ryan. But Bill was competent in his own areas of expertise, and he had been much more dependable in her life.
"How's she doing?" Bill asked.
"Better. What's going on with Joel Lambert?"
Bill shook his head. "That little thug really is a piece of work," he said. "He's talking anyway. He says he knows some guys who made a lot of money off of young girls, and he thought he'd give it a try himself."
No signs of remorse. He's a sociopath to the bone. Anyway, he'll definitely be convicted and get jail time. He'll probably do a plea deal, though.
Riley frowned. She hated plea deals, and this one was especially upsetting.
I know how you feel about that, Bill said. But my guess is he'll talk up a storm and we'll be able to put a lot of bastards away.
That's a good thing.
Riley nodded. It helped to know that some good was going to come out of this terrible ordeal.
But there was something she needed to talk about with Bill, and she wasn't sure how to say it.
Bill, about my coming back to work.
Bill patted her on the shoulder.
You don't have to tell me, he said. You can't work cases for a while. You need to take some time off.
Don't worry, I understand. So will everybody at Quantico. Take as much time as you need.
He looked at his watch.
I'm sorry to rush off, but...
Go, Riley said, and thanks for everything.
She hugged Bill, and he left.
Riley stood in the hallway, thinking about the near future.
Take as much time as you need, Bill had said.
That might not be easy.
What had just happened to April was a reminder of all the evil that was out there. It was her job to stop as much of it as she could. And if she'd learned one thing in life, it was that the evil never rested.
Chapter 2. 7 weeks later. When Riley arrived at the psychologist's office, she found Ryan sitting alone in the waiting room.
Where's April? She asked.
Ryan nodded toward a closed door.
She's with Dr. Sloat, he said, sounding uneasy.
They had something they needed to talk about alone. Then we're supposed to go in and join them.
Riley sighed and sat down in a nearby chair. She, Ryan, and April had spent many emotionally demanding hours here during recent weeks. This would be their last session with a psychologist before they all took a break for the Christmas holidays. Dr. Sloat had insisted that the whole family participate in April's recovery. It had been hard work for all of them. But to Riley's relief, Ryan had taken part wholeheartedly in the process. He'd come to all the sessions that he could fit into his schedule, and he'd even scaled back his work to make more time for this. Today, he'd driven April here from her school.
Riley studied her ex-husband's face as he stared at the office door. In many ways, he seemed like a changed man. Not long ago, he'd been inattentive to the point of serious delinquency as a parent. He'd always insisted that all of April's problems were Riley's fault. But April's drug use and her much too close brush with forced prostitution had changed something in Ryan. After her stay in the rehab clinic, April had been home with Riley for 6 weeks now. Ryan had visited often and had joined them for Thanksgiving. At times, they seemed almost like a functional family. But Riley kept reminding herself that they had never really been a functional family. Could that change now, she wondered. Do I want it to change? Riley felt torn, even a little guilty. She'd long tried to accept that her own future probably didn't have Ryan in it. Perhaps there might even be another man in her life. There had always been some kind of attraction between her and Bill, but they'd also fought and quarrelled from time to time. Besides, their professional relationship was demanding enough without throwing romance into the mix. Her kind and attractive next-door neighbour, Blaine, seemed a better prospect, especially since his daughter, Crystal, was April's best friend. Still, at times like now, Ryan almost seemed to be the same man she'd fallen in love with so many years ago. Where were things headed? She really didn't know. The office door opened and Dr. Leslie Sloat stepped out.
We'd like to see you now, she said with a smile.
Riley had long since taken a liking to the short, stocky, good-natured psychologist, and April was clearly fond of her too. Riley and Ryan both went into the office and sat down in a couple of comfortable, upholstered chairs. They were facing April, who sat on a couch beside Dr. Sloat. April was smiling weakly. Dr. Sloat nodded for her to start talking.
Something happened this week, April said. It's kind of hard to talk about.
Riley's breathing quickened, and she felt her heart beating faster.
It's got to do with Gabriella, April said. Maybe she should be here today to talk about this too, but she's not, so...
April's voice trailed off. Riley was surprised.
Gabriella was a stout, middle-aged Guatemalan woman who had been the family's housekeeper for years. She had moved in with Riley and April and was like a member of the family.
April took a deep breath and continued.
A couple of days ago, she told me something I didn't tell you, but I think you should know. Gabriella said that she had to leave.
Why? Riley gasped. Ryan looked confused. Aren't you paying her enough? He asked.
It was because of me, April said. She said she couldn't do it anymore. She said it was too much responsibility for her to have to stop me from harming myself or getting myself killed.
April paused. A tear came to her eye.
She said it was too easy for me to sneak out without her knowing. She couldn't sleep at night, wondering if I was putting myself in danger. She said that now that I was healthy again, she was moving out right away.
Riley was jolted with alarm. She'd had no idea that Gabriella had been thinking any such thing.
I begged her not to go, April said. I was crying and she was crying too, but I couldn't change her mind and I was terrified.
April choked back a sob and wiped her eyes with a tissue.
Mom, April said, I actually got down on my knees. I promised never, ever to make her feel that way again. Finally, finally, she hugged me and said she wouldn't leave as long as I kept my promise. And I will. I really will. Mom, Dad, I'll never make you or Gabriella or anybody worry about me like that ever again.
Dr. Sloat patted April's hand and smiled at Riley and Ryan. She said,
I guess what April's trying to say is that she's turned a corner.
Riley saw Ryan take out a handkerchief and dab his eyes. She'd very rarely ever seen him cry, but she understood how he felt. She felt her own throat catch.
It was Gabriella, not Riley or Ryan, who had made April see the light.
Even so, Riley felt incredibly grateful that her family would be together and in good health for Christmas. She ignored the dread that lurked deep down inside, the awful feeling that the monsters in her life were going to take away her holiday.
Chapter 3. When Shane Hatcher walked into the prison library on Christmas Day, the wall clock showed that it was exactly 2 minutes before the hour.
Perfect timing, he thought.
In a few minutes, he was going to break free. He was amused to see Christmas decorations hung here and there, all made of coloured styrofoam, of course, nothing hard or with edges or useful as rope. Hatcher had spent a lot of Christmas holidays in Sing Sing, and the idea of trying to evoke the holiday spirit here always struck him as absurd. He almost laughed aloud when he saw Freddy, the taciturn prison librarian, wearing a red Santa hat. Sitting at his desk, Freddy turned toward him and smiled a cadaverous smile. That smile told Hatcher that everything was set to go as planned. Hatcher silently nodded and smiled back at him. Then Hatcher walked between two shelves and waited. Just as the clock ticked the hour, Hatcher heard the sound of the loading dock door opening at the far end of the library. In just a few moments, a truck driver came in, pushing a large plastic bin on wheels. The dock door closed noisily behind him.
"What you got for me this week, Bader?" Freddy asked.
"What do you think I've got?" the driver said. "Books! Books, books."
The driver took a quick peek in Hatcher's direction, then turned away. The driver, of course, was in on the plan. From that moment on, both the driver and Freddy treated Hatcher as if he weren't there at all.
Excellent, Hatcher thought.
Together, Bader and Freddy unloaded the books onto a wheeled steel table.
"How's about a cup of coffee over in the commissary?" Freddy said to the driver. "Or maybe some hot eggnog. They're serving it for the holiday."
"Sounds great."
The two men chatted casually as they disappeared through the swinging double doors out of the library. Hatcher stood quietly for a moment, studying the exact position of the bin. He paid off a guard to nudge a surveillance camera little by little over a period of days until there was a blind spot in the library, one that the guards who watched the monitors hadn't yet noticed. It looked like the driver had hit the mark perfectly. Hatcher silently stepped out from between the shelves and climbed inside the bin. The driver had left a coarse, heavy packing blanket at the bottom. Hatcher pulled the blanket over himself. Now was the only phase of Hatcher's plan when he thought that anything could possibly go wrong. But even if somebody came into the library, he doubted that they would bother to look inside the bin. Others who might ordinarily have checked the book truck closely as it left had been paid off too. Not that he was worried or nervous. He hadn't felt such emotions for some 3 decades now. A man who had nothing to lose in life had no cause for anxiety or unease. The only thing that could arouse his interest was the promise of the unknown. He lay underneath the blanket, listening closely. He heard the wall clock tick the minute.
5 more minutes, he thought.
That was the plan. Those 5 minutes would give Freddy deniability. He could honestly say that he hadn't seen Hatcher climb into the bin. He could say he'd thought Hatcher had actually left the library earlier. When 5 minutes were up, Freddy and the driver would return, and Hatcher would be carted out of the library and then driven out of the prison. Meanwhile, Hatcher allowed his thoughts to stray to what he was going to do with his freedom. He had recently heard some news that made the risk worthwhile, even interesting. Hatcher smiled when he thought about another person who would take keen interest in his escape. He wished he could see Riley Page's face when she found out he was at large. He chuckled ever so softly. It was going to be nice to see her again.
Chapter 4. Riley watched as April opened the box containing the Christmas present that Ryan had bought for her. She wondered just how in tune Ryan was with his daughter's taste these days. April smiled as she took out a bangle bracelet.
"It's beautiful, Daddy," she said, giving him a kiss on the cheek.
"I hear it's quite the style these days," Ryan said.
"It is," April said. "Thanks."
Then she gave Riley a barely noticeable wink. Riley suppressed a chuckle. Just a few days ago, April had told Riley how much she hated these silly bracelets that all the girls were wearing. In spite of that, April was doing a great job of acting enthusiastic. Of course, Riley knew that it wasn't entirely an act. She could see that April was pleased that her father had at least made an effort to buy a Christmas present that she would like. Riley felt much the same way about the expensive handbag Ryan had bought for her. It wasn't her style at all, and she'd never use it, except when she knew Ryan would be around. And for all she knew, Ryan felt exactly the same way about the wallet she and April had bought for him. "We're trying to be a family again," Riley thought, and for the moment, they seemed to be succeeding. It was Christmas morning, and Ryan had just come over to spend the day with them. Riley, April, Ryan, and Gabriella were all sitting near the roaring fireplace.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.